Welcome to Contest Night! My name is Bill Morrell. I am glad to have you here, as well as Luke Toastmasters successfully speaking, as well as our Toastmasters trio of clubs from Northern Trust. On behalf of Northern Trust clubs, welcome. Thank you for coming tonight. Extreme pleasure to introduce your Central North Division Director. Please welcome Wayne Taylor!
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming. I just want to ask the area directors for Central North to come up with me. They're not strangers to you, and this night couldn't have been done without them helping you, your clubs, grow. I want to say thank you for all the contestants. We're going to have a great night. I'm going to hand over to Anise Anderson, who is going to be our contest master tonight. Hand of applause for Anise Anderson.
Having my mic. Woo! Yes. District 30, are you ready?
Yes.
Come on now, I don't hear you. Are you ready?
Yes.
Well, welcome to the Central North C Division contest led by our very own Wayne Taylor. Give him a hand, please. Yes. I'm Anise, also known as Queen of Hearts, and I'm so happy to be serving as your contest master for this evening's Table Topics and International Speech Contest. Yeah. Okay, for the contest, what would we do without our dignitary support? Some of them are in the house tonight, so let's welcome and thank them. Give it up for our District Director, Ivory Gwynn. Our Program Quality Director, Cassandra Lee. Our Growth Director, Tiffany Howard. Director Bill Morrell. Central South B Division Director Shanitha Burton, my daughter. And again, our very own Central North C Division Director Wayne Taylor. Yours truly, Anise Anderson. B11 Area Director Kat Hennington. Monty, yes, she. B14 Area Director Chihi. Area Director Monica. Stand up, Monica. I'm sorry, sweetheart, I got taken out the last name. I don't want to mess it up. C22 Area Director Margo Weinstein. She's in the back. the 23 Area Director, Valerie Smith. C25 Area Director, Benita Barkley. D31 Area Director, Stella Lawrence. My very own F83 Area Director, Stephen Mustang. My very own F84 Area Director and my son, Encore Patel. We have a lot of dignitaries in the house. That's wonderful. That is wonderful. All other area dignitaries and past district leaders, please stand if you're in the house. We welcome you and thank you as well. Thank you. Now, we can't run a contest without our awesome functionaries, our ballot counters, timers, sergeant-at-arms, assistant sergeant-at-arms, judges, and last but not least, our chief judge. Thank you. Give them a hand. Do you all know what this evening's theme is? Does anybody know? Come on, guys. We have to get ready for the launch. Okay? And if you're here this evening, I know you're ready to party, right? Am I right?
Yes.
Well, let's get up. Give yourselves another hand. Thank you. Okay, let's get ready for a great contest. Our contestants have prepared to give great presentations, and we are prepared to give them our undivided attention. At this time, please silence anything that beeps or makes a noise. Unless it's keeping you alive, then by all means, crank that sucker way up. You know what? I stole that line from someone. I'm getting ready for my humorous speech contest. Was that fun?
Yeah.
But thank you. No photography of the contestants will be allowed during this contest because there'll be plenty of opportunities later. Thank you. The sergeant at arms will secure all doors once the contest has begun. No one be allowed to leave or enter the room during the contest. After all the ballots are collected, you will be allowed to leave or enter the room. As a friendly reminder, or as a reminder, the first place winners will represent the division at the spring conference to be held April 28th and April 29th, and more information will be given to you about that at our break. You gave me that smile, thank you. At our break, we encourage you to support our winners tonight at the spring conference, so go back and make sure that all of your clubs are registered, okay? You promise?
Yes.
Okay, great. And now, let's give our contestants our full attention. Contestants, good luck to each of you. Now let's begin our Table Topics contest. For this contest, only the first contestant will remain in the room. All other contestants will be escorted from the room by the sergeant-at-arms. Each competitor may stay in the room after completing the competition. Table Topics contestants, please raise your hands. Thank you. All of the contestants are in the room and have been fully briefed, as well as all the judges, functionaries, and sergeant-at-arms. The contestants have been informed of the location of the timers. Where are my timers? Thank you. And the speaking area. There are no restrictions on the speaking area. Each contestant will be introduced by announcing the contestant's name, the table topics question, and I will repeat the table topics question and then the contestant's name. Responses will be 1 to 2 minutes long. Speaking less than 1 minute or more than 2 minutes and 30 seconds will disqualify a contestant. Timing will begin with the contestant's first definite verbal or nonverbal communication to the audience. The green indicator will be shown at 1 minute and remain showing for 30 seconds. The amber will be shown at 1 minute and 30 seconds and remain on for 30 seconds. And the red will be shown at 2 minutes and remain on until the presentation is concluded. There will be 1 minute of silence between contestants, allowing the judges to mark their ballots. After the last contestant, the judges will be given as much time within reason that they need to complete their ballots. The speaking order of the contestants has been determined, and the order is as follows. This is the time if you want to mark it in your program. Table topics. Contestant number one, Steve Bu. Contestant number two, Greg Thompson. Contestant number three, Lisa Bricker-Rich. Contestant number four, Laura Rebby. Contestant number five, Tim Wilson. And our last contestants for table topics will be Alan Rutson. Sergeant at Arms, would you please prepare the first contestant during this 1 minute of silence and escort the other contestants to our soundproof area? Thank you.
Yes, we will.
Yeah.
Timers, 1 minute of silence, please. Contestant number one, Stephen Bu. On April 29th, District 30 will be launching a new legacy. A legacy isn't only about leaving what you've earned, but also what you've learned. What type of legacy do you want to leave? On April 29th, District 30 will be launching a new legacy. A legacy isn't only about leaving what you earned, but also what you've learned. What type of legacy do you want to leave? Stephen Bu, help me give him a hand.
Thank you.
about a legacy, I think about me being dead. But I guess I have no choice about that, so it's good to think about a legacy. And when I think about a legacy, the first thing that pops into my mind are my three children. 1, 2, 3. I'll never forget the days of their birth. I'll never forget their first days of school. I'll never forget that horrible disaster that happened to them that they thought would be the end of their lives, but it wasn't. It turned out to be a small thing in each of their cases. I'll never forget their first boyfriend or girlfriend. And in the case of the girls, oh, I didn't like that too much. But I got used to it, and it turned out just fine in both of my daughters' cases. I'll never forget their wonderful progress through life and their challenges. And I guess I'll have to think of them surviving me and me leaving them a legacy. What will my legacy be to my three children? Really the most important people I can think of when I think of a legacy. Tell the truth. Be upright to other people. Always do the right thing. If you do make a mistake, which you will and I have, apologize. Make it right. If they do those things, I can have faith and confidence they'll have wonderful lives. Madam Contest Master.
One minute of silence, please. Contestant number 2, Greg Thompson. Greg, on April 29th, District 30 will be launching a new legacy. A legacy isn't only about leaving what you've earned, but also what you've learned. What type of legacy do you want to leave? On April 29th, District 30 will be launching a new legacy. A legacy isn't only about leaving what you've earned, but also what you've learned. What type of legacy do you want to leave? Greg Thompson.
Chair, fellow Toastmasters and honored guests, a legacy that I would like to leave as a Toastmaster is a legacy of accomplishment. I've been in Toastmasters since 2007, and since that time, I have accomplished a lot as a Toastmaster. One thing I had done is I joined my club, and then I started serving as an officer. And after serving as an officer, I got involved in the contest. And the contests have been so exciting. It took me from a shy, stuttering Toastmaster to actually the district champion in 2009. So with that Toastmasters, what I do now is, in effect, I give back. I mentor clubs as they come along. I've mentored 3 clubs so far, and it is so rewarding. Looking in the eyes of a new Toastmaster. I just met one today. And knowing that I can help them, I can get them started. I know in District 30, the issue is not getting clubs. The issue is retaining clubs. You gotta get those clubs to stick around. And my number one legacy for getting those clubs to stick around is mentorship. You gotta talk to those people. You gotta get out and, as they say, shake hands, kiss babies. You gotta do that. That's the kind of stuff, that person to person, that's the kind of stuff that gets people to, what is, as we say in the business, stick and stay. So my legacy for Toastmasters is a legacy of mentorship, and hopefully that will last long after I'm world champion.
One minute of silence, please. Contestant number 3, Lisa Bricker-Rich. Lisa, on April 29th, District 30 will be launching a new legacy. A legacy isn't only about leaving what you've learned, but also what you've learned. Excuse me, let me rephrase that. A legacy isn't only about leaving what you've earned, but also what you've learned. What type of legacy do you want to leave? On April 29th, District 30 will be launching a new legacy. A legacy isn't only about leaving what you've earned, but also what you've learned. Lisa, what type of legacy do you want to leave? Lisa Bricker-Rich.
Toastmasters and distinguished guests. Legacy. That is a big word. And that brings a lot of thoughts to my mind. And the legacy that I would like to leave is of someone who cared, someone who tried really hard, someone who was thoughtful, someone who was of service, someone who took the responsibility of raising children and did the very best that she could do. I would like my legacy to be people would think kindly of me, that they would think of me, and their heart would smile, that they would think of me, and they would think that even though she was afraid, she did it anyway. And I would like my legacy to be that she was a good wife, and a good sister, and a good friend, a good daughter, a good listener, and that she could tap dance pretty well. When I think of the word legacy, I get tingles all over my body. Because we all have the opportunity every day to leave, to create our legacy. So I encourage you to also think about, what would you like your legacy to be? And I think that you would find, when you feel those tingles and you feel your heart smile, that you will know that is exactly the legacy that you would like to leave.
Yeah, 1 minute of silence, please. Contestant number 4, Laura Rebby. On April 29th, District 30 will be launching a new legacy. A legacy isn't only about leaving what you've earned, but also what you've learned. What type of legacy do you want to leave? On April 29th, District 30 will be launching a new legacy. A legacy isn't only about leaving what you've earned, but also what you've learned. Laura, what type of legacy do you want to leave? Laura Rebby.
Toastmasters, dignitaries, and guests, what legacy do I want to leave? Let me start with a story. Back in October of 2016, my husband's 91-year-old grandfather passed away. We went to Central Illinois for his funeral. He had lived in the same house his entire life in a small town in Central Illinois. He was a farmer, as you can imagine, and he had been farming this piece of ground his entire life. His father had farmed it, and his grandfather had farmed it. They go back generations. When we went to this funeral, we saw everyone from the farming community, from probably 3 counties, show up. They all expressed what an impact this man had on their lives, how kind he'd been, how when he talked to you, he really talked to you. And when you were talking to him, he really listened. And what an important person he was in their lives. He didn't have a lot of money. He had no power. You would not call him an influential man. You would not call him a great man by a lot of today's society standards. But what I took away from that funeral is what it really means to be a great human being. He was kind, he was thoughtful, he was engaged with you when he was talking to you, and he made you feel like the most important person in the world when he was in the room with you. That is the kind of legacy I would love to leave on this earth. I would love for my children to think of me and say, man, when mom was home with me, she was here, and she was thinking about me, and she was loving me. Same thing with my friends, my husband,
my own parents. I want them to think of me as a kind person, a thoughtful person, an engaging person. So that's the kind of legacy I would like to leave. Madam Conference.
Silence, please. Contestant number 5, Tim Wilson. On April 29th, District 30 will be launching a new legacy. A legacy isn't only about leaving what you've earned, but also what you've learned. What type of legacy do you want to leave? On April 29th, District 30 will be launching a new legacy. A legacy isn't only about leaving what you've earned, but also what you've learned. What type of legacy do you want to leave? Tim Wilson.
Some answer that's come up over and over and over again, you're desperately hoping that I don't give. Problem is, I've been, of course, out in the sound isolation booth out there and have no clue what that is. So I'll just kind of say what I'm thinking and keep on going along, and hopefully I won't bore you too much. What legacy would I like to learn? I think the legacy I'd like to leave, frankly, is about speaking, and I know some of you are checking out right now, but it's true. I didn't start in Toastmasters interested in speaking. I started in Toastmasters because I want to go into management. Anybody got that goal, that purpose of going into management? Thinking a little bit, a few people. Okay, great. Well, I'm not in management yet, but amazingly enough, I became more interested in the speaking. And what's sort of legacy? I want to help people understand speaking is so easy. It's all about finding your passion. And it's all about doing the unexpected. For instance, one of the greatest things about a speech where you're told there is absolutely no limit on where you can be is you can stand back here, and then people have a problem. They got to figure out, do they want to turn around and face me? Do they want to ignore me for the whole time? They want to just kind of pretend I'm up there and keep staring up there, hoping desperately that I'll return? Or what are they going to do? And this teaches you the power of public speaking. Friends, when you go public speaking, you have power over your audience, not only to manipulate their bodies, but manipulate their minds and their souls. It is amazing the power you have, because right now, people follow me everywhere I go. You don't want to follow me. She's anticipating. Without you have the legacy, you have power in your speaking, you have power in the passion in your mind and what you're talking about. So that's really, if you want to leave a legacy, it's just about that simple. Find your passion, folks. Find your speech. If you haven't given a speech yet, and Toastmasters or whatever, speak up, because your voice needs to be heard. A lot of things going around. A lot of passions are going around. A lot of people feeling a lot of things. Just speak it. Say it. Make it happen. Make it yours.
One minute of silence, please. contestant number 6, Alan Redson. On April 29th, District 30 will be launching a new legacy. A legacy isn't only about leaving what you've earned, but also what you've learned. What type of legacy do you want to leave? On April 29th, District 30 will be launching a new legacy. A legacy isn't only about leaving what you've earned, but also what you've learned. What type of legacy do you want to leave? Alan Redson.
Fellow Toastmasters and dignitaries, what a great beginning we have with our legacy, the new legacy, and the journey that we're on. But we all have personal legacies and things that we would like to leave behind and go forward. Let me share with you one that is hard for me to talk to you about, because obviously it's a failing. I procrastinate. I procrastinate way too much. But I have great plans. I take my train home at night, and I think of the things that I want to be doing to get ready for tomorrow. And in most cases, it's things that I want to do tonight. And I'm motivated, and I'm ready. And I got plans, and I walk out that train and into my house. It's only a short walk, 10 minutes. And boy, all those great plans, all that energy I had, goes away. I have a nice dinner, I watch the news, and what's the next thing I do? It's on TV tonight. Blackhawk game? Yeah, that's cool. We'll do that. One of my favorite TV shows? Yeah, I got one every day. I probably watch it. I'll watch one hour, and then I'll get back to it. That briefcase, with that laptop, and those plans, never opened, never touched. And what do? I wake up early the next morning, I have breakfast, and I'm trying to do the things I should have done the night before. That's the legacy I have to change. I have to reinvigorate myself and somehow change that pattern of when I walk in the door.
A moment of silence while the judges mark their ballots. The judges will have all the time they need within reason. And once the ballots are all collected, we will be notified. Moment of silence. We're still waiting for all the ballots to be collected.
Madam Toastmaster, all ballots
have
been collected.
All right, thank you. Let's give our contestants another hand for an awesome table puppet contest. Give it up for them now, please. Contest chair, can I have fun with the contestants and get to know them better, or would you like announcements? Okay, we have announcements by Cassandra Lee. Congratulations, our program director. Right?
Give our contest master a round of applause. As your program quality director for District 30, you may have heard me mention in a few previous events that I serve as the VPE for the district. That's what the PQD stands for, program quality director. So I'm focused on education and training and all of the good stuff that we do, like contests tonight, all under my leadership. You might have noticed in the back a flyer about a special report. Many of you already received the February issue because you supported the area contest. And I really appreciate those of you that gave me feedback about all the information that was provided. Yeah, I know it was a lot of info, wasn't it? But it made for interesting reading on the train, didn't it? Good. The next issue will come out toward the end of the month. It will be for March, and what we're doing is focusing in on making certain that you know where your clubs stand. There's also a business card in the back of the room as well. For those of you that serve as vice presidents of education of your club, on the back of the card, we'll give you details on the next PQD VPE teleseminar that I'll be doing. The next one is coming up the first Tuesday of April. The details are on the back of the card for how you can connect. That's the PQD side of information. Now, here's the real side of the announcement. The 2017 Spring Conference. We are truly launching a new legacy. In the back of the room, I want you to make certain when we take a break that you grab both of these flyers. One is to provide you with the details on the Spring Conference itself, the date, the location. The second flyer is for you and your club members to start participating and getting prepared to participate in what we are calling the Virtual Banner Parade. Yeah, some of your faces changed when I said virtual. Virtual Banner Parade. What that means is we're looking for all clubs to take a photo with their club banner. You and all your members, get creative with it. Make certain, though, that it is the TI branded banner. So that means any banners with the old logo, those won't be accepted. Yet as long as you're using the new banner, your photo, as long as it's good and clear, will be provided to our chair, to our banner parade committee, and they're going to include that in a video loop. So what that means is throughout the conference that weekend of April 28th and 29th, you will have an opportunity to not only attend educational sessions, be a part of the district business meetings, hear the business briefing, as well as hear the contestants from tonight's table topics and international speech contest. You will get a chance to see yourself throughout the weekend being highlighted in the virtual banner parade. Bill Murrill, our sergeant at arms, is holding up some in the back of the room. Feel free as we take this break to make certain that you grab a flyer for your club. If you have any questions, the contact name and number is on the flyer. And of course, one of my business cards is in the back. I'll also be able to assist you as well. It is at this time that I would like to bring back our contest Toastmaster, who will do the official end of this first contest and send us off to our first break. Let's welcome back Anise Anderson.
Having fun?
Yeah. Yeah.
I hope so, because that's what Toastmasters is all about, and don't forget that. Here?
Yes.
Okay, like our program quality director said, we will take a 10-minute break, and we'll see you here back here in 10 minutes. My timers will time us. Thank you.
Give yourself a round of applause! It is showtime! Please take your seats!
Before we start the contest again, we have some movie prizes over here. We want to give these prizes out to you as a way of thanking you for coming tonight. I was in awe when I found out that 75 people registered for my contest. I to ask my lovely assistant, Anita,
I believe I got everyone, but did everyone get a raffle ticket?
Yes. Prize number one goes to 678825. That's 678825. No one shouting yay, I have one, so let's see as we go. Oh, you're just waving your ticket. Sorry, Captain. Next ticket is 678817.
Ooh.
Oh, wow. Wow.
Freeze-dried ice cream in the theme of getting ready for brunch.
The one that fell out. 678770.
Dang. I know.
I'm not cheating here, by the way.
Trust me, I don't need to exercise.
Oh, yeah. Okay. You are on camera.
What we're also doing in the spirit of Toastmasters is we want to give something different outside of a gift. And so what we have is the district leaders have kindly given us the ability to gift you them to come to your club and give a speech. So, and what I have in my hand is a list of all clubs within the Central North Division. So, shake this and get someone to search. Okay. And that club has no name.
Come on, Wayne.
Did I get given the right pit because these don't have any names on?
Jeez.
Oh. Okay.
Where's Monica?
What happened?
This is your table topic.
Okay, this is
it. So I'll give you these and said these are the ones you need.
She gave the right.
Oh, okay.
Do you have the clip ones?
Wayne, is the cup on the podium?
Al?
Yes.
Do you have those with you?
There's a cup on the podium.
Okay, Al is your guy.
Apparently they're on here.
It's my fault.
Oh, you're actually doing
it. No, that was walking again.
There's going to be some boo and hisses if you pick Michigan Avenue right now. Speakers Forum.
Oh.
Wow.
Anise left the building. I'm her twin sister. So if that's okay with you guys. You ready?
Yes.
Welcome back from your break. Give yourselves a hand. Did you eat enough food?
Yeah.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, did you know that on this day in 1954, especially ladies, the first shopping mall opened in Southfield, Michigan? Did you know that?
No.
I don't know. You have to Google it. Also, guys, the Beatles released their first album, Please Please Me, in 1963. Just a bit of information. And just a friendly reminder to silence anything that beeps or make noise, or else you will be automatically ejected from your seat, but I don't know where you're gonna go. Probably out the window or something. So silence those beepy phones. Thank you. Now it's time for our international speech contest. This contest will be conducted using the same procedures as Toastmasters International uses in conducting the international speech contest. The judges, contestants, functionaries, and sergeant-at-arms have been fully briefed. The contestants have been informed of the location again and the timers and speakers area. For this contest, all contestants may remain in the room. International speech contestants, raise your hands. Great. All contestants are present and have been briefed. Contestants will be introduced by announcing their name, speech title repeated, and their name. Speeches shall be from 5 to 7 minutes long. Speaking less than 4 minutes, 30 seconds, or more than 7 minutes, 30 seconds will be means of disqualification. Timing will begin with the contestant's first definite verbal or nonverbal communication to the audience. The green indicator will be shown at 5 minutes and remain shown for 1 minute. The amber at 6 minutes and remain shown for 1 minute. And the red at 7 minutes and remain on until the speech is concluded. There will be 1 minute of silence between each contestant to allow the judges to complete their ballots. After the last contestant, the judges will be allowed all the time needed, again, within reason, to complete their ballots. The speaking order for the contestants have been determined, and it is as follows. Contestant number one, Valerie G. Contestant number two, Sharita Lucas. Contestant number three, Greg Thompson. And our last contestant, number four, Sue Ramirez. Each contestant will be introduced by their name and title of their speech. I will then repeat the title and their name once again. Are there any questions? I don't think so. So we will now begin the International Speech Contest. Sergeant in Arms, could you please prepare the first speaker, the contestant, during this 1 minute of silence? Contestant number one, Valerie Ann G. Muslim in the house. Muslim in the house, Valerie Ann G.
Take a look at me. A good look. I look like I'm a communicator, right? Did I listen to people? Yeah? Not sure? I do. I listen to people. I look like I'm a loving, accepting kind of a woman, right? Yes. That's what I thought too. Until I met Ehab. A few years ago, my hubby and I went to Cairo, Egypt. We were there to sign a business contract with Vodafone for 2 years. We were met at the airport by this tall, dark, handsome Egyptian James Bond. Hello, my name is Ehab, at your service 24/7. Fabulous, bodyguard, driver, and guide. A few months later, we sent our team of consultants, led by our daughter, Sarah. Blonde, blue-eyed, attractive, American, Bond girl. I know what you're thinking, and you're absolutely right. They fell in love. They got married. They had a baby. And then they came to Chicago to live with us. Madam Contest Master, fellow members, honored guests. Have you ever had people come stay with you and never leave? It's really great. There was strangeness in my house. Stinky Egyptian cheese in the fridge, prayer mats on the floor, quotes from the Quran on the wall. In the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful, I seek refuge from the mischief of darkness. I was the darkness. Problems with everything that Ehab did, the way he parked his car, the way he walked, the way he sat, the way he talked, the way he breathed, the way he wore his mustache. And I just, even when he did something nice, so for example, I would be away on a business trip in the hotel at night, and my cell phone would go on. Hello? Hello, Mama, this is Ehab. I know. Are you okay, Mama? Yes, I'm okay. Are you okay? Yes, I'm okay, Mama. I'm just checking you are okay. I'm okay. Good. Good night, Mama. Good night, Ehab. What was wrong with me? My own family never called to tell me. And here's this guy, my son-in-law, father of my grandson, the man that my daughter loves, and I was just being horrible. I decided I would read uplifting quotes in the morning. I would wake up and Deepak Chopra, Come From Love. Joel Osteen, the smiling pastor, accepting. The Bible, scripture. Beloved, we must all come from love, for love is from God. John 4:7. And I would float downstairs on a cloud of love and acceptance. And there would be Ehab, still in his pajamas, putting 10 spoonfuls of sugar into his tea and stirring really loudly. Ding, 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 ding. Cup of tea, Mama? No, thank you, Ehab. Just my kitchen back, please. Oh, what was I gonna do? How could I get rid of this darkness that was within me? I decided I would write a book, a self-help book for myself. It would be my therapy, and I would call it Muslim in the House. And I asked Ehab, may I write a book about you? Of course, Mama, no. He's a jokester like that. And actually, Egyptians are the jokesters of the Arabic world. Anyway, over the next months and years, we got into communication, to commune, to be at one with. And I asked him about the culture, about the Quran, and I listened with deep respect. I didn't debate or argue. I didn't tell him about my beliefs. I simply listened. And I was shocked to learn that Jesus and Mary are highly respected in the Quran, that many of the stories are the same as those that I knew in the Bible. I learned that the mother is first place, second place, and third place in importance in a person's life. I am a mother. That's why he was calling me to check if I was okay. That's why he would ask me, cup of tea, Mama, 10 times a day. I also learned that the word Muslim means one who submits to God. How wonderful is that? So, a few weeks later, my grandson comes in carrying his father's prayer mat. Jeff, my hubby, and I, and Sarah were sitting having breakfast, and he put the prayer mat on the floor, and then he looked at us with expectation that we would lead him in morning prayer. We had no idea what to do. So we said, you lead us. And the next thing we are praying and bowing, Alakar, Abar, Alhamdulillah. It was the most cherished moment. Friends, family isn't just people who are close to us. As I have learned in Toastmasters, family is me, is you, is everybody out there. And when we listen with deep respect, and when we get into communication and we commune with one another, we find that our hearts really open with love and acceptance. Take a look at me. I am proud to tell you that I have a son, a Muslim Egyptian son, and his name is Iha.
One moment of silence, please, 1 minute. Contestant number two, Sherita Lucas, the power of forgiveness, the power of forgiveness, Sherita Lucas.
Draw the line at an unfaithful spouse? What about a parent who's let you down? How about a confidant who speaks words spoken in confidence? What about a friend who steals? You see, we spend so much time stuck, either unwilling or unable to forgive. We often come up with a number of reasons for doing so, right? I won't forgive because he needs to learn a lesson for what he's done. I won't forgive because I ain't doing nothing wrong. I won't forgive because forgiving is for me. You see, here's the problem with being stuck. It's often accompanied with a lot of pain. Pain that I'm intimately familiar with. Let me take you back to a time before my preteens when I realized for the first time that my idol, my mom, I realized that she was flawed, imperfect. It was a devastating realization. Imperfection was a characterization that I just was not mentally equipped to bestow upon my idol. Looking back, I guess you could say that I had unfairly placed her on the pedestal with no place left to go down. I know. Nonetheless, I viewed her as my African warrior princess. She was my divine all-knowing advisor, my fortress guardian, kicking ass and taking names in her relentless pursuit at protecting me and my two younger sisters. But like I said, she was flawed. And while she fought fearlessly and bravely to protect our clan, our once safe fortress was invaded by monsters. Because she lost her own epic battle with addiction. Monsters who roamed freely. Monsters who roamed inappropriately. But just like children blessed with that spirit of unconditional love, even those egregious transgressions were easily forgiven. Now, fast forward to adulthood,
when my mom committed the cardinal sin of stealing from the very children that she had a moral obligation to protect, and something inside of me just broke. I was instantly catapulted from one end of the emotional spectrum, which was love and admiration, right into the outstretched arms of hatred that comforted me like a warm, fuzzy blanket. You see, my friend Hatred wasn't accustomed to dwelling alone. He'd often invite in anger, depression, and guilt, and I let them all take up residency for 10 long years. 10 years. And over that time, my overall health began to deteriorate. My mood swings became erratic. My relationships suffered. My self-esteem took a heavy hit. You see, my friends, I was stuck and in a lot of pain. But all of that ended for me one day. When my innocent little 5-year-old, when he looked me in the eye, and out of the blue, he asked, "Where's your mommy?" Where's my mommy? Ooh. I guess it's true what they say, right? You hear what you need to hear when you need to hear it. Well, conscious awareness kicked me in the gut. That feeling was overwhelming. I instinctively jumped up and I just started driving. And that woman who met me at the door, she looked familiar. She was a little grayer, a little heavier. She walked with a cane. I recognized the African warrior princess. No words were spoken that day, just an embrace. How do I describe that embrace? Let's just say I felt like a starving woman who'd finally gotten a chance to eat. I've been on a journey of self-healing ever since that day. And what I've learned is that the choice to forgive is the ultimate gift that we give to ourselves. I learned that the moment that I chose hate is the very moment that I severed that connection to my compassionate self. And I share this story with you guys today in the hopes that you will give yourself that gift of forgiveness. Will today be the day that you reconnect with your compassionate self? Consider today your very own impromptu intervention. Remember, you're hearing what you need to hear because you need to hear it.
Silence, please.
Thank you.
Contestant number three, Greg Thompson. Broke, not broken. Broke, not broken. Greg Thompson.
To live your dreams, overcoming obstacles is an absolute necessity. To live your dreams, your obstacles have to be your reasons why, not your excuses or why not. Your obstacles have to strengthen you, not weaken you. To overcome your obstacles, you have to have vision. You have to have a vision that extends to however long it takes to live your dreams. Since there's no real cookie cutter formula on how to overcome obstacles, the best I can do is give you an example. Contest Toastmasters, fellow Toastmasters and honored guests, I had a dream to retire my mother and buy her a home so that she could live her golden years comfortably. I enjoyed some of the finer things in life. That's what success looked like for me. I had a lovely 4,000 square foot home. I drove a beautiful gold Lexus sedan. I had a great job working for an amazing company that paid me a great salary. I traveled nationally and internationally. I was on top of the world, or so I thought. After I happened time to go into great detail, that great company collapsed on me. I lost my primary source of income. I thought that company would be there forever. How many of you think your job is going to last forever? I counted on that company for lifetime income. In the meantime, I lost everything. And I do mean everything, except my spirit. I lost that home and moved into a tiny apartment. I sold that beautiful car at a huge loss and bought me a used Pinto. At the height of my financial devastation, all of my bank accounts were closed and overdrawn. My credit cards were closed and over the limit. My cell phone got turned off. I can hear the phone company saying, "I bet you can hear me now." My car insurance was canceled for non-payment. But that was okay because a few days later, they repossessed my Pinto.
Oh my God.
I was being asked to move from my apartment for not paying. Finally, on September 1st, they shut off my utilities. My mom passed away a short time after that. I never did get a chance to buy her that home like I said I would. And on top of everything else, I no longer have electricity or hot water. I was as close to being homeless as a man could be without being homeless. And there was some really humbling moments. Taking cold showers was humbling. Having no money to get a haircut or a shave. I did have hair then. And at times, no money for food. I can remember standing in my living room one day. I was up on the third floor, looking out the window, and I seen a homeless man sitting against a building across the street eating a sandwich. And I said, "Dang!" That's not what I really said. Even he gets to eat today. I know of very few experiences more humbling than being hungry. Being 34 years old and not having money to buy something to eat made me realize I was broke, not broken. Broke described my circumstance. Broke did not define who I was as a human being. I was not less than a homeless man. Less money, perhaps, but not less of a man. During this period of time, my attitude, believe it or not, never wavered. There is in each of us an indomitable spirit, And I called on that spirit, and by sheer determination, I used my obstacles to strengthen me, not weaken me. I used my obstacles as my reasons why, not my excuses of why not. For example, instead of saying, I can't succeed because I have no phone, I'm broke, and I have no car, I said I must succeed because I have no phone, I'm broke, and I have no car. It's January, a year and a half later, I'm back on my feet again, I have a great job again, and a plan B just in case. How did I do it? The credit goes to my mother. It was the values that she taught me as a child. My mom pushed me to acquire skills. She encouraged me to never give up. And she instilled in me an unwavering faith in God to help me in my battles. That was my number one asset for overcoming obstacles. Thanks, Mom. Lessons learned along the way? Baby steps are steps too. It was important for me to get out there among the population and not let grass grow under my feet. I had to get out there with nonstop networking. I had to push myself to do what I had to do to keep from becoming complacent. Even if it means, would you like to have fries with that, sir? Some of you will get that on the way home. And some of you won't. Our values do not define us. It is our unwavering faith in God. A rich man, I am not, but I feel as though I've lived a successful life. I have so much to be thankful for. To live your dreams, overcoming obstacles is an absolute necessity. And remember, broke is your circumstance, not your identity. Extend your vision to however long it takes, and let no obstacle stand between you and your God-given right to live your dream.
One minute of silence, please. Contestant number four, Susan Ramirez, Finding St. Anthony. Finding St. Anthony, Susan Ramirez.
Good evening, everyone, fellow Toastmasters and Toastmaster. Tonight, I'm going to take you on one of the fastest-paced journeys you've ever been on. What we're going to do is a little bit of my life journey, one that took me 50 times around the world. I've never been out of the U.S., but tonight, we're going to go out of the U.S., and who are we going to go find? We're going to find Tony. Tony is the man of faith who put me on this journey. Yes, I'm Italian, and yes, we do a lot of praying to the saints, okay? My grandma taught me how to pray really good, and we found St. Anthony down in a little neighborhood church. Bottom line, I had a lot of faith in life. I took 8 friends with me the first year we went to church. All of us went. Why? Because St. Anthony is the woman's man for a man, or a woman's saint for the man. Everybody came with me, and all 8 of us went on the journey to church. For 9 nights, we did the little novena. The next year I go back, the priest says, "Where's all the women at with you, Sue?" He goes, "This year you only got one." I go, "They did really good." He goes, "Yep, he always finds those men or whoever you need to find." I go, "You got it, Father. They're all gone." So what do? I find one the next year, and I get married. The feast day of St. Anthony is June 4th to June 13th. So I turn around, get married on June 7th, because I'm thanking God I found this man, and we got married, and everything's going good, and life's journey keeps going. All of a sudden, wow. 27 years of marriage, and I find myself in divorce court. I said, "Matt, what happened to the saint? Saint, you promised me faith. You told me it was going to go good." I said, "What in the world am I doing here today? This was not how it was supposed to be after everything." So I'm sitting there praying away. The divorce goes on, get the divorce. I'm losing everything because I didn't know working women lose these days. So anyways, I go back out and I sit there and I go to church right down at Holy Name, because only God puts me in the Holy Name district. So I go over there and I said, "Oh, there's a priest from Padua, Italy." He says, "I'm Father Mario. Pray good. Here's the statue from Padua, Italy." I said, "Oh, this is a miracle." I said, "It's here tonight out of all the nights. I got divorced today." He goes, "Good, pray hard. Here's Messaggiare. Sign up. It's from Italy. And don't worry." He says, "Keep praying. God puts you on weird journeys." I said, "Yes, he does." So I did all that. Bottom line, I start writing this Messaggiare, and I get a letter. I go, "Come to Italy? Who's sending me a letter?" Some priest is saying, "Father Giancarlo, come to Italy. I got the place for you. $65 a night." $65 a night. I've never been out of the U.S. So I call my daughter, who says, "Oh, Ma, you can go yourself. You'll probably be fine after all these years." I said, "I've never been out of the U.S. So off I do. I get a passport. I get a ticket. 2 weeks before I go, I get a phone call. My daughter says, "Mother, I'm coming with you. Don't worry about a thing." Oh, okay. This is going to be a piece of cake. Got a room, going into Venice. We drop down in Venice. Guess what happens? I said to my daughter, "Oh, are you ready? We got to figure out our way to Padua." She goes, "No, you got to figure out your way to Padua." I go, "What do you mean?" She goes, "Forgot to tell you, I found a college roommate. I'm going off to Venice, and from Venice, I'm going into Milan." I said, "Oh, Lord." All of a sudden, I turn around. She's gone. I got luggage all over the place. I said, what did you do? "Bye, Ma. Take luggage with you. Bye." She's got a backpack on her, so off she goes. So I'm like, "Oh my goodness, I don't believe this." Now, the kids got me in Italy, so all right, I go to the guy, "Cab. Can I take a cab?" He goes, $200, $200, no way. I'm not taking no cab for $200. So I turn around, I said, "To the bus." The guy goes, "I hope the bus comes today." I go, "What do you mean you hope the bus comes?" He goes, "They go on strike whenever they want, they come when they want." Okay, off we go, here we go again. Luggage in hand, okay, back to the bus. Boop. There we drop down in Padua, Italy. Where is Father Mario? He's gone. Go find Father Giancarlo. I said, "Well, he's the one who wrote the letter." So I'm running around Italy. I'm in this big basilica down there for $65 a night. You couldn't beat it. And I said, "Oh, Padua, this is beautiful. No one talks English with my luck." So not one person talked English. Nobody knows Father Giancarlo, who writes me the letter with the hotel room for $65. In the meantime, I've got the backpack on me because all the women in the church gave me letters to bring to St. Anthony to thank him for everything and pray for them. I'm looking all over. I get turned around in church on the feast day. And I said, "Father Giancarlo." I yell out. Tons of priests out there. "Father Giancarlo." All of a sudden, the guy turns around and goes, "See? See?" I said, "It's me, Sue from Chicago." And he's like, "Huh?" And he looked at me in this crazy look like, "Who the heck are you stalking me?" And he goes, come. So I came with them. He goes, come. "Hold on. Somebody come and interpret." You know, so he gets an interpreter. "Christine, here she comes." She goes, "What are you doing here?" I said, "I got faith. I had to find the priest." I said, "Because everybody's got them letters, and only I can tell him I got married on the feast day, June 7th, and for some reason, the saint got me divorced on June 11th, in the middle of the novena."
I said, so for 38 years I've been praying. Now I got this marriage, divorce. What is it? He goes, oh, that's easy. He starts laughing and laughing. I go, why is he laughing so much? He goes, he's never met a woman like you. You got such faith. You came with a backpack, 50, 60 envelopes from all these women in the church. I go, yeah. And she said, he's enjoying this because he said you got so much faith that you took a journey on a bet that you'd find him, and there's 300 priests here, and he can't believe you turned around in church and he's in front of you. So the moral of the story is, have faith, and when you have a lot of faith and you take a journey, you always sometimes find things that you don't realize exist. And he looked at me and he goes, go back home, enjoy your life, I'll see you in a few years. I'm like, okay. And he said, have the faith of your life and take a journey. He goes, because sometimes there's ups and sometimes there's down, but at the end, it's an amazing journey. Thank you.
The judges mark their ballots and the ballot collectors collect the ballots.
Madam Toastmaster, we have all the ballots.
All right, all the ballots are collected. Thank you. Let's thank our International Peace Contest contestants for a great contest. Fun with our our contestants and get to know a little bit about them, a little bit more about them. Can my table topic contestants please come up here and join me on the stage? Thank you. That all of you all were fantastic. Thank you for a great contest. Yeah. And I'm going to talk to Stephen first. Where's Stephen? Step forward, Stephen. Hey. Stephen, I'm looking at your profile, and do you know Chinese? Can you speak a few lines for us? Say, I love you, Toastmasters.
I don't know how to say Toastmasters in Chinese, but, well, I need Toastmasters.
Okay. And Stephen, I love children because I have four granddaughters of my own, and I see that you have three. Tell us a little bit about the feisty one.
The feisty one is the little one. Her name is Polly, and being the youngest one in the family, she had to fight to survive.
All right, what club are you with?
I'm with Successfully Speaking and Loop Toastmasters, and I'm here tonight on behalf of Successfully Speaking.
And how long have you been a Toastmaster?
In 6 years with Loop Toastmasters and 3 years with Successfully Speaking.
All right, Stephen, thank you for your presence. Greg Thompson. Hi, Greg.
Hi.
How are you? What club are you with?
I'm representing tonight AT&T Toastmasters, but I'm also with Bellwood Toastmasters as well.
That's awesome. How long have you been a Toastmaster?
Since 2007.
Wow. Okay, guys, here's the experience up here. Here's his number. Now, you like serving and helping people. Can you elaborate on that for us?
Yeah, as I said in my table topics, is that so much has been given to me by Toastmasters. I came into Toastmasters as a really stuttering idiot. And so it was just really a mess. When I had my first table topics question, they asked me a question, and I just answered it. And that was it. It was like 10 seconds, and I was gone. I was so shy and inhibited, I almost passed out when they asked me to get in front of everybody and speak. It was just that terrible. But now I like giving back what they have given to me, and Toastmasters has given me an awful lot. So I've served the district as the area director, and hopefully I can serve it even more.
Awesome, and we know you definitely don't have that problem now.
No.
Thank you. Thank you for your presence. Come on, Lisa. Hi, Lisa with the pretty yellow shirt. I want that. Can I have it? At least tell me where you bought it. Okay, Lisa. You know, Lisa, I was reading your profile, and you got a lot going on, girl. Now, Lisa, I love to work out. I love fitness, clean eating, healthy eating. Lisa, you are an extreme workout. Can you explain to us about the extreme workout deal?
Thank you. Actually, it is, in hindsight, it is more of a balanced workout, is what my intention was in saying that. That in my life now, more than ever before, I have balanced workouts. And it really feeds my soul to work out. It really feeds my soul, so it's something that I do for myself at least 5 or 6 times a week. And there was a time where it was not balanced, and through the years it has become balanced. And I am really proud of that, and that is the best way that I can have longevity with working out. And so I feel because of that, in many areas of my life, that's just one area that has become more balanced. So it was my intention in writing that, because I do love it so much. It just feeds my soul every day, and then I can be the best that I can be for my family and for my friends and for the world, and it just is more balanced in my life.
Well, you look great. Check her out. And one more thing, I can't let you go. Tell us a little bit about this human connection.
Oh, my God.
Well, I love people. I just adore people. I find people so fascinating. And when I was younger, I thought that everybody was like that, that everybody enjoyed the human connection. And I was so blessed and lucky to have a job that in my life that was all about the human connection, and that was being a concierge at a hotel. So multiple times a day I had the opportunity to meet many different people from all over the whole world. In seconds, different people. It was the most amazing experience. I feel like it was life 101, and I had the honor and pleasure of working there for over 20 years. So it is just deeply, I hold it dear. Very dear. And so that was just wonderful that my passion for human connection, well, I was able to do that every day. So I felt so blessed.
That's awesome. Thank you. And what club are you representing?
Michigan Avenue Toastmasters.
Thank you, Lisa. You've been great. Thank you. Laura. Club are you with, and how long have you been a Toastmaster?
I am with Premier Toastmasters. We're in the Merchandise Mart. Been with that club for a year and a half. I've been in Toastmasters.
Awesome. Okay, guys, hold on to your seats right now, because Laura played volleyball against Misty May, the Olympic beach volleyball gold medalist. Give her a hand. Outdoor with her two children. Tell me about that. Tell us about that.
I have two daughters, a 9-year-old and a 5-year-old, and they are, as you can imagine, go, go, go all the time. We live on Lakeshore Drive, so we have the opportunity of having Lincoln Park literally across the street. So they've got play bow and arrows that have like a little pillow on the end of them. We go out there and play, we run, we ride scooters, we ride bikes, we've got a bag at the ready in the storage closet with Hi-Li and a soccer ball and frisbees and all sorts of stuff, so that at the drop of a hat we can just go across the street and play in Chicago's biggest backyard. We had a backyard in our old house, and everybody asked me if we miss it. I'm like, no. Biggest backyard
now. That's awesome. And you like to dance?
I'm not very good at it.
Laura, thank you for your presence. Okay, Tim. Hi, Tim. This is Tim Wilson. Tim, what club are you with? What are you representing?
String Toastmasters. And I'm also with Toastmasters Lincoln Park.
Great. Could you tell us about your professional speech coaching?
I'm a professional speech coach. Want to talk about a speaker? I do. The nice thing about it, from my point of view, it's like one of those workout clubs where you go and you pay the money, and you kind of hope that'll make you better just because you keep on paying the dues. So if you pay the dues, you might not have to do anything. It's fine with me. I'll take the money. But if you really want to get better, I can help you with that, too.
Well, Tim, that's awesome, but I don't understand. Tim's favorite quote is, "It's a terrible death to be talked to death." Can you please?
I don't think I need to explain that. I think the audience understands exactly what I'm talking about. Have you ever been in a meeting where you just kind of hope, you know, whatever you think about our gun control, you may think, just take a gun, go up to the person who's speaking, say, "Look, it's either me or you, but I can't take this anymore." In that situation, you know, it's horrible for the audience. My point of view as a speech coach, also to save the audience. Folks, audience are dying every day out there. I can save one speaker. I can save countless of audiences all across the country.
Okay, Tim, thank you. You've been awesome. bring Ellen forward. Hi, Ellen. What club are you representing, and how long have you been a Toastmaster?
So I'm representing a Chicago here Toastmasters. It's a company club, and I'm one of the charter members of that club, so about 5.5 years now.
That's awesome.
Yes.
Can you explain to us, you said you like working with people with passion.
Sure. So that's a big thing for me, and I think if you're put in a situation, you realize it as well. Doesn't the work seem to go better, faster, and more rewarding when you're working with people that have a vision, and you feed off of that vision, and they feed off of your energy? And I've had a great opportunity several times in my life to have those kind of things happen to me, and I certainly look forward to the next one.
That's awesome. Thank you, Alan. You've been great.
Thank you.
Let's give all our contestants a hand. Thank you, guys. Thank you. Now let's talk to our international speech contestants and learn a little bit more. Come on up and join me, guys and girls. Hi, Valerie. Oh, we're not done. Valerie, hi.
Yes, hi.
Can I have the voice now? I asked you once before. Your accent.
Oh, you can, yes. Just do you
want. Okay. Here I am. Valerie, what club are you representing?
The Michigan Avenue Toastmasters.
Valerie, she likes people who take risk. Valerie, explain it.
My husband and I have always taken risks. You know, he parachutes, I scuba dive. I also parachute. We trekked to Mount Everest base camp. We came to America, for goodness sake, in 1983 for 2 years, and we stayed. So, you know, that's the kind of people we are, risk takers.
Risk takers. That's awesome. How long have you been a Toastmaster?
3 months.
Oh, wow.
3 months. Well, you are incredible.
Thank you.
Valerie G. Hi, Carnita. Carnita, Sharita, Lucas. Don't kill me, please. How are you?
I'm good, thank you very much.
You're welcome. What club are you representing, and how long have you been a Toastmaster?
Loop Trustmasters, and I've been a member for a year and a half.
You love Zumba. Do you teach Zumba classes?
That's one of my dreams.
Oh, but you love doing it.
I love Zumba. I try to get in. I'm a Zumba girl. I try to get into a Zumba class at least 4 times a week. Yeah. Mm. And the last time I was in a class, I got brave and I got up on the stage. And then I realized that when you're on the stage, you have to do everything backwards. And when I looked out at the at everybody on the floor, everybody stopped because they were trying to figure out what I was doing. So I need a little bit more practice.
And Charnita's children.
Sharita.
Oh, I'm messing up
That's
your name.
Okay.
Charita's children inspire her. She have tears in her eyes.
Most of my speeches are inspired by the people closest to me in my life, and my mom happens to be one of them. And my oldest son is here today. No better legacy in this world than to have children like mine. I have the best children in the world. So. Yeah. And he got into medical school.
Thank you for being you, and thank you for all that you do.
Thank you.
Hi, Greg. Again, how are you? Well, since I've asked you questions in your first round, we need you to just volunteer something inspiring for the entire audience today.
Okay. Well, maybe most of you don't know, but I used to teach ancient Egyptian history. I taught it for 7 years and took all of my students to Egypt as a field trip. And that was definitely a life changer, to go to Egypt, see the pyramids, see the tombs, and we did it as a cruise, cruising down the Nile to Thebes and Abu Simbel, and that was amazing. I filmed the whole entire thing. The class came back truly energized.
Thank you, Greg. You are great. Last but not least, Susan, but I can't talk to her unless you have Tony with you. Tony? Oh, he's over there.
He's in the band, but we
can't
get him.
Okay, Susan, what inspires her is life and people. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, I think in everything, as we kind of age in life, I don't want to say that, but as you age a little bit, you think back and you say, God, what am I doing here? What are we doing? And I think sometimes you go through so many journeys, sometimes not a lot. Some people get hit with a lot more journeys than others. Some people kind of go a little bit different route, and it's an easier journey. But I think through the whole thing, you just have to sit back and say, life is a huge journey. And I joined Toastmasters for this journey that I decided to take on after everything. I went and joined the Case Challenge at my job. And so for my job, I took on Toastmasters. And it was a great thing because I won first place at the company in Toastmasters for the Case Challenge, and this really helped. So people, I love a journey in life, and you got to go on.
Thank you for loving us. Can we give our international teachers another round of applause? Thank you. Thank you very much. At this time, I think we will. Thank you guys. Give them another hand. Come on. At this time, I think we will have announcements. We will bring up our district director, Ivory Gwynn. Come on down here, Ivory.
Wasn't that a great contest?
Yes.
Man, I learned a lot. But I want you guys to learn something that you need to know in the next 2 months. And to help you learn this, I'm going to ask Bill and Tiffany to come up and give you a hug, not again.
Tiffany, do you know what happened Sunday, April 2nd?
If you don't renew your dues, your Toast membership has lapsed.
No, the Cubs are playing! The Cubs started the World Series!
I'm a Cubs fan, but I was not going there.
Yes,
today.
But the day before, you just broke the ice on. Tell us about April 1st instead.
So April 1st is when your Toastmaster dues are officially due.
Yes.
So hopefully if you pay those, you can go to the Cubs game. But yes. If you are enjoying your Toastmaster membership, how many of you enjoy your membership? You're paying it, whether your company's paying it, whether you have the advantage of your children paying it for you, whatever it might be, we hope that you renew your dues. Why, though?
Because for $7.50 a month, which is $7.50 by 30 days, or about a quarter a day, you can have not only great interaction, you can talk about the Cubs anytime you want during table time, or the Sox, or anything besides sports. We really want you to continue to have a World Series caliber place within Toastmasters, and we need to do that by filling the seats, by getting your friends and your family, your coworkers involved with something you know is even better than baseball, even better than sports, even better than sitting at your job, and that's connecting with people through Toastmasters. So please pay your dues and continue to extend that World Series feeling to the people around you. Mr. District Director.
How many of you have a CC in here? Competently communicating.
Two.
I would like everyone to get a CC. If you get a CC, a competently communicator, it gives you, just makes you, it gives you the ability to stand up and talk without any problems. Your window of opportunity is shrinking. If you've not noticed in the world today, your window of opportunity is shrinking. So, now, for me, I'm a distinguished Toastmaster, but I do get nervous. I do get nervous, especially when the CEO is telling me your numbers are wrong. And I was like, back in the old days, I would say, I'm gonna lose my job. I gotta do something, I'll go back and look at those numbers. Right now, they say your number's wrong. I said, no, it's not wrong. It's been running, it's been producing those numbers every day. The difference is it's wrong in the system. And that's the information. Whatever information is given, it's the right information. Well, your number's wrong. I said, no, it's not. See, when you have confidence in yourself, and Toastmasters give you confidence, mm-hmm. no matter what's going on, whatever anybody is saying to you, it gives you the ability to say, hey, I know my value. That's what we're trying to get you to do. Learn your value. So that when people test your value, you stand tall and say, you know what? This is what I'm giving you. It's right no matter what. Now, you guys want to know the results.
Yes.
And I don't know if we're going to do that. Yeah, are we going to raffle or are we going to do a result?
No, we got to get going.
Okay, then. Come on up here.
All right, I'd like to bring up, and I certainly enjoyed being your contest master this evening, and I hope you had a good time. And now I'm going to turn it over to Wayne Taylor.
Ladies and gentlemen, a bit of a drum roll. Third place, the table topics is...
Let me hope they don't get this
wrong. Lisa Brickett. Greg Thompson. And drum roll. First place in the table topics, the Central North Division is Laura Remy. National Speech Contest. Since we only had four speakers tonight, we're only going to announce second and first place. So, drum roll please. second place for the International Speech Contest is Valerie G.
Yay!
Final drum roll for tonight, please. The winner of the International Speech Contest for Central North Division is Greg Thompson. We'll raffle those off, and then we'll have the photo opportunity, okay?
Okay. Let's wrap it up.
I'm being told, let's... Okay. So for those willing to wait, after I say the meeting is adjourned, we will do the raffle. I'm going to call this meeting closed.